Johnny Baker schon ein bisschen länger und am Anfang habe ich ihn immer abgespeichert unter dem Stichwort Emerging Church. Also die, die reflektieren, die denken, die ganz theoretisch über eine Kirche von morgen nachdenken, die auch dekonstruieren, aber die gleichzeitig auch tun und ausprobieren und experimentieren und sich gemeinschaftlich auf die Suche machen. Und dieses Praktische, das kann man auch bei Johnny sehen. Johnny hat nämlich eine ganz tolle Website, Worship Tricks, weil er auch ein totaler Experte ist der sogenannten Alternative Worship Bewegung. Und in diesem Zuge hat er auch einige richtig tolle Bücher geschrieben, Alternative Worship, The Labyrinth, Transforming the Ritual, Creating Worship, Pioneer Spirituality und das letzte Buch, da hörten wir ja gestern schon von, The Pioneer Gift, die Gabe des Pioniers. Und damit komme ich auf das Thema, das schwerpunktmäßig heute Vormittag vorkommen soll. Johnny Baker ist Director of Mission Education am CMS, Christian Mission Society in Oxford. Und man merkt dieses Pioniergehen, diese gemeinschaftliche Suchbewegung, weil Johnny gesagt hat, herzlichen Dank für die Einladung, aber ich komme auf gar keinen Fall alleine, sondern ich kann mit den Leuten, die mit mir zusammen unterwegs sind, mit Leuten, die halt genauso in der Praxis und auch in der Theorie drinstecken, so wie ich. Und deshalb begrüße ich auch sehr herzlich Suzanne Hähnen. Die arbeitet nämlich auch beim CMS in Oxford und arbeitet in der Abteilung Vocation. Ich glaube, die katholischen Brüder und Schwestern unter uns würden das mit Berufungspastoral übersetzen. Und wir Protestanten würden vielleicht sprechen von einer gabenorientierten Förderung. Und wenn man vielleicht managementmäßig drauf guckt, würde man von einer Personalentwicklung sprechen. Aber sie macht nicht nur das, sondern sie ist eins zu eins an ganz vielen kleinen Beispielen dran, indem sie individuell Menschen fördert und begleitet, als Tutor und Mentor. Somit herzlich willkommen, Johnny Baker, Suzanne Hähnel. Vielen Dank.
Which is an Anglican church, and when I look in that direction, I'm grateful for the dangerous memory of Jesus that's been passed on to me through the tradition of the church. I've come to follow Christ. But when I look in that direction culturally, I don't feel at home. The world of the cathedral is, in England we would say, quite Radio 3. It's a particular milieu. Not where I feel at home. When I look in the other direction, I see this building here, which is the Tate Modern, which is an art gallery in London. It represents, I suppose, do we use the word postmodern now? But postmodern life in London, creative, buzzing. I feel at home culturally here. I'm actually a member of Tate Modern. And it struck me when I was on this bridge that this is my life. I'm caught between these two worlds, and I want to mess this picture up. I want to bring the story of Jesus, the resources of the tradition and the church, but I want to bring them across the bridge to share with the culture of the Tate Modern. Actually, I'd quite like to bring some of the culture of the Tate Modern across the bridge the other way. So that's my life's quest, that's my journey. I'm caught in this space, as it were. For the last 7 years, we've run a leadership training program for pioneers. Now, pioneer's a funny word. I think it's a funny word in German as it is in English, or can be a difficult word. But it's a word that we've used to describe people who are starting new things beyond the edges of where the church is at the moment. And when our students finish training with us, which takes them normally about 3 years, we wanted to come up with a symbol, a sign of the journey that they've taken as a pioneer, and this is what we came up with. They all get given a tile like this that's made by an artist friend of mine, Ian. And the reason he came up with this was because this looks like a landscape in which there is nothing, but actually a pioneer makes a journey or makes a way where there is no way. So this is what we give to people. And I think, I thought I'd bring this to show you. I could leave this as a gift maybe for Kirke Hockenswey. Because it seems to me that that's the quest that you are on, that you are all on. How can you make a way in your community, in your neighborhood, where there is no way, where you can't see a way at the moment? That's the quest, I think. That's the question. And I very much love this theme of wandering. And I think particularly that the challenge is to wander beyond the edges of where the church is at the moment. I mean, in England, even if the church does really, really well, we're only going to reach a small group of people. I mean, the church maybe is, I don't know, 4 or 5% of the population. So even if we do well, there are particular milieus who kind of relate to that. But there's masses of people that, however well we do it, are not going to come to church. So we need people to wander into the neighborhoods, the cultures, the communities, to leave home, to be with people in the spaces and communities where they are. So I love this idea of wandering, and I look forward to the book that you will produce. And I love the word wonder. Now, I'm not sure if the word wonder for you means quite the same as us, but for us, the word wonder is about dreaming, it's about imagination, it's about possibility. And I understand for you, it's kind of about surprise. So maybe it could be about all of those things together. But I wonder what happens if we stop hanging around the church all the time and be with people in the spaces there where they are. I wonder if God is there. I wonder what God is doing. I wonder what would happen if we joined in with what God is doing. I wonder what it will feel like if I let go of the old ways of doing things that don't make sense in this new space. Will I find a new way to do things? How will I draw on the tradition to do that? I wonder if I'll fail. I think these are some of the things we wonder as we journey into a new space. But anyway, I love that theme very much indeed. Somebody mentioned this yesterday. One of my favorite definitions of mission is from a guy called John Taylor, and he describes mission as an adventure of the imagination, which very much relates to wandering, I think. What might it look like when I move into a different culture, a different community? What possibilities are there? How might things open up as we seek to follow Christ in that space? Because in most of these communities, books that are written to tell you how to do things that you can pull off the shelf don't work. The answers aren't in a book. They're to be found as we go on that adventure of the imagination. So I love that idea of adventure. And it seems to me that you are a community of adventurers, I think. I went on a retreat about 2 years ago to try and be silent for several days, but also to reflect on pioneering, and particularly with the pioneers who trained with us, what is at the heart, or we would say, what is the charism or the gift that's captured in this pioneering? And I wrote some things in this book here. I called it True North, so it was great to see the room with the compass on the floor yesterday. It was almost as though we planned it. But the idea of True North, I think, for me, was thinking that for pioneers and people who've struggled with church and wanted to do new things, I suppose I've seen some people deconstruct and leave the church, but actually they've ended up not doing much that's transforming in a space. They just seem to have a lot of questions and not much changes. Whereas it seemed to me that being part of a mission community, CMS, a lot of the pioneers who've done that journey seem to have been able to stay faithful to Christ and be kind of pulled towards wanting to change the world in missions. So I was wanting to think, what is it about that gift? And I thought that this morning would kind of whiz through some of the things that we thought about as part of that gift. I'm part of a photography group, and this was a project in our photography group, a self-portrait. But the first part of this gift, I'm kind of stating the obvious here, is about pioneering. And I don't know what you understand by the word pioneer, but a lot of the students that we've interviewed over the years, at some point in the conversation, they often say to me, to be honest, I've never really fitted. So I've come to use a shorthand for pioneering, which was mentioned yesterday, as the gift of not fitting in. Now, what isn't good about that is it just sounds like we're awkward or odd or difficult. I mean, maybe we are, but I think it's not so much that. It's about if the world or the church is organized in this way, we don't somehow, and Sebastian pretty much described this yesterday. He struggled to fit into that structure because he saw other possibilities. And one definition, the simplest I found, the one that I like very much of pioneer, is from a friend of mine called Beth Keith. And she says a pioneer is someone who sees future possibilities and works to bring them to reality. I mean, I can give these slides to Maria and Sandra if you want these slides at the end, so don't feel you need to take notes. So the two things about this, the first is it's a gift of sight. And I was talking to someone yesterday who's a designer, and I think many artists and designers are close to this gift because there's a seeing. If business as usual in the church, or actually in cultures, systems, organizations, is in this direction, invariably the pioneering gift sees something over here or over here. This may be going really, really well for people. This isn't to say this is bad. There are people for whom this doesn't work, this doesn't fit. So it's a gift of sight. And I think it's very much tied up with the gift of the prophets in that way. It's seeing different possibilities or even different worlds. And then secondly, it's a gift that's about building things. It's not out of what we see, out of that possibility, we're able to make something happen. So we're not just dreamers. This is a friend, Bernie, who's a student on the course. She's a wanderer, very much a wanderer. She spends 4 days a week wandering around her part of London, meeting people and making things happen out of that. But one of the phrases we quite like is dreamers who do. So it's about seeing and building. And one other way that we talk about this gift as well is as descent. I don't know what the German word for descent is. Descent, there we go. So it's alternative to the possibility that exists. We need to break with the usual ways of doing things, to descent, and I'll come back and say a bit more about that later. So that's the first aspect of the gift. Over to you.
The zweite Aspekt ist Mission. Und das Interessante in dem, was wir machen, ist, dass das Training, das pionierische Training in einer Missionsgesellschaft stattfindet. Und viele haben das am Anfang komisch gefunden und gedacht, was machen wir denn da? Aber das Wichtige ist, weil Mission ja von einem Ort zu dem anderen geht, das sind die gleichen Fähigkeiten, die wir erwarten, die wir Menschen mitgeben wollen. Zu sagen, wir gehen von einem Ort in das Unbekannte, in das Neue, in irgendwas, was wir noch nicht genau wissen, aber was wir versuchen zu experimentieren, wo wir lernen, wo wir die gleichen Fähigkeiten nutzen, die wir uns mehr in die Mission geben. Mission ist so ein schwieriges Wort für viele. Es hat so viel Baggage mit dabei, so von Geschichte und wie so viele Dinge schiefgelaufen sind. Aber ich denke, manchmal müssen wir einfach Worte wieder nutzen und neue Bedeutung geben und sagen, Mission heißt auch von meiner Straßenseite zu der vom Nachbarn zu gehen. Mission heißt auch, den Menschen, der vor mir steht, wieder ganz neu zu sehen. Und da gibt es so vieles, was halt Mission uns lehrt. lernen kann, was wir von Missionaren, von Leuten, die Missionstheologie und verstehen, mitnehmen können. Und das ist was, was CMS so super macht. Wenn ich das auch so selber sage. Das ist ein Bild von dem Vincent Donovan, schrieb ein Buch. Vincent Donovan schrieb ein Buch über die Maasai in Afrika und wie er dort in diese Gruppe ging. Und das ist, nicht sein Versuch, aber ein Versuch zu überlegen, wie sieht Christus, wie sieht Gott in der Tradition, in der Kultur anderer Menschen aus. Und manchmal geht das auch ein bisschen schief. Manchmal laufen wir so rum wie Aliens, die nicht so wirklich verstehen, was passiert um uns herum. Aber diese Kultur verstehen, damit komme ich zum dritten Schwerpunkt, diese Inkulturation, zu verstehen, was treibt die anderen Menschen, was ist denen ihre Kultur. Wir sind Menschen, die geschickt worden sind, wir sind von Gott gesendet und das hat das Gleiche mit der Mission. Mission und Inkulturation gehören so irgendwie eng zusammen. Das Evangelium, die gute Nachricht, kam nicht ohne einen Kontext, die kam mit Kontext. Und da heißt es wieder ganz neu zu überlegen, was ist an diesem Kontext der Kontext und was ist die gute Nachricht, wenn ich das so auseinandernehme. Was ist wirklich so das Ganze drumherum und was ist der goldene Kern in Christus, wie man so schön sagt. Und das bedeutet häufig, dass wir so ein bisschen loslassen müssen von dem, was wir gerne verstehen, was uns wohlfühlend macht, was uns komfortabel macht. Das andere interessante Element von Unkulturation ist, dass man Gott besser sieht. Ich nutze immer das Beispiel, wenn man eine Statue hat und man schaut die Statue an und schaut von einer Seite, da sehe ich ein was. Wenn ich aber eine ganze Menge andere Menschen um mich herum habe, die Dinge anders sehen, sehe ich ein viel volleres Bild von der Statue. Und so ähnlich ist das mit Gott, denke ich, wenn wir Grenzen überschreiten, wenn wir uns auf den Weg machen mit anderen Menschen, dass wir Dinge sehen, die wir vorneweg nicht gesehen haben.
Yeah, freedom. It's freedom that Christ has set us free, and it struck me quite forcibly on this retreat that in the church I'd not come to experience Christianity as always being free. It felt quite hemmed in. So, for me, this is one of the most important words. There is great freedom in Christ. There's great possibility. God is at work in the world, and the kind of things that could be done are huge, they're vast, there's so much we could do. And you are free, as followers of Christ, you are free, and the imagination is free. So I hope that you can lean into some sort of freedom. We're going to go through these quite quick, so we can talk about some other things as well. I mean, this was very much said yesterday by Sebastian, Hannah, and Steffi, I think, in the interviews. But one of the things I realized through working with Pioneer students was that quite a lot of them, when they heard the word pioneer, they were worried because they thought about the most pioneering person that they'd ever met and thought, I don't know if I'm a pioneer because I'm comparing myself with them. But what I've realized through working with students is that actually God's call to you is not to be someone else, it's to be the gift of who you are. So Hannah's life's work is to be more fully Hannah. My life's work is to be more fully John. You don't have to be me, which is lucky for you. And that gift is unique. You bring particular things through who you are, particular talents and skills. So Christ's call to you, in terms of this pioneer gift, is to be who you are as you wander and as you wonder. And then one of the things I'm really pleased about that a lot of pioneers go to the edges. They go to the margins. They go to people who are disenfranchised, whether because of economy or race, or they're refugees, or they're struggling to do with mental health. They feel marginalized because of sexuality, or whatever the issues are. I think Christ went to the edges a lot of the time. So one of the things I've reflected on too is that actually this gift is about being called to the edges. Not exclusively. There's some people who work, they're pioneering for people in business or whatever it might be. So don't hear me saying you can't do those other things, but I think there's something about the call to be with those at the margins.
Christlikeness. Weißt, was wir festgestellt haben in Reflektieren, ist, dass wir versuchen, die Menschen, unsere Studenten, denen zu helfen, Christus besser zu verstehen. Wenn wir Christus besser verstehen, können wir Christus besser sein zu unseren Nachbarn, zu unseren Mitmenschen. Es ist keine Rocket Science, es ist eigentlich ganz einfach. Mehr wie Jesus werden und mehr wie Jesus leben. Und Johnny hat es schon erwähnt, Christus ging an die Ränder der Gesellschaft, die Margins der Gesellschaft. Das ist einer der wichtigen Punkte für uns. Missionsspiritualität, Missionsgeistlichkeit. Was wir festgestellt haben, ist, dass es gut ist, es wichtig ist, Dinge neu zu gestalten, aber das Neugestalten sehr einsam sein kann. Und in diesen einsamen Zeiten ist es wichtig, dass wir Systeme, Menschen, Communities finden, mit denen wir gemeinsam unterwegs sein können. Wir sind als CMS eine Orden, im Grunde genommen, ein Orden der Kirche. Und wir haben uns dazu wie verschrieben, dass wir gemeinsam leben und lernen und Mission praktizieren. Dass wir aktiv selber an der Mission teilnehmen, dass wir davon lernen, dass wir gemeinsam auf dem Weg sind. Und das ist, für Menschen sieht das verschieden aus, für viele sieht das so aus wie, wir haben ein paar ganz enge Menschen um uns herum. Für mich sieht das so aus, dass ich freitagabends mit 2, 3, 4, 5 guten Freunden zusammensitze. Wir essen, wir beten, wir reden. Das füttert meine Missionsspiritualität.
So, just one story. A pioneer, a friend of mine, Andrea. So her wandering has taken her to connect with spiritual seekers or people at New Age fairs. Do you have the same thing, mind, body, spirit communities? Yeah? No? So these would be people. So this would be a big festival in London where people are going to read tarot cards, have their aura taken, alternative health, kinds of things. So Andrea, together with others, set up a stand at that sort of a festival to try and share Christ with seekers. And it probably won't surprise you to know that the way that we do things in church, if you did that in the Mind, Body, Spirit Festival, wouldn't work. So she has to let go of a lot of things and wonder what in the tradition might possibly connect in this sort of space. And actually, some of the old things in the tradition connect well. So some of the treasures in terms of prayer and so on, and prayer for healing for people that are very into healing. But actually, the language that you use there is challenging. If you talk about God as Father, if you talk about church, these things don't go down well. But if you talk about God as the divine, or church as a spiritual community, that kind of language works. So in a new space, how are you going to speak? What language is going to connect there? And one of the things that we've done there is to use the cards. Every one of these places is into card reading, and there's a deck called the Jesus deck, which I won't explain now, but we basically use those cards with people as a kind of reading using Lectio Divina to talk about, and people love it. They're like, oh, I've done tarot, I've done this, I haven't done the Jesus deck, can I have a go at that? So So that's one example of the story. Second example.
Die zweite Geschichte, über die wir kurz reflektieren wollen, ist die Geschichte aus dem Lukas-Evangelium, Kapitel 8. Jesus geht über den See, fährt über den See, Genezareth, glaube ich, nach Gerasimen. Das war in der Art. Die Theologen unter uns würden das richtig aussprechen können. Was nicht Galiläa ist, ist das Gegenüber von Galiläa. Es geht aus dem gewohnten Weg heraus in einen neuen Weg. Und er geht über Grenzen hinweg zu einem Mann, der dort Dämonen besessen ist, der ausgegrenzt ist von der Gesellschaft. Im Grunde genommen ein verrückter Mensch ist. Leute haben ihn abgeschrieben und er ist dort auf einem Friedhof unterwegs. Das Wundern und das Wandern führt uns manchmal auf Plätze, wenn wir Jesus folgen, und Orte, die wir so nicht uns vorgestellt haben. Das Interessante an der Geschichte ist, dass nachdem Jesus ihn heilt, er mit Jesus mitgehen will. Und Jesus stellt fest, wenn er das zulässt, wird dieser Mann Jude werden müssen. Er muss sich komplett umstellen, sein ganzes Leben wird umgekrempelt, er wird aus seiner Kultur, seiner Gesellschaft herausgenommen werden müssen. Und er sagt, weißt du was, es ist viel besser, wenn du hier bleibst und hier vor Ort überlegst, wie das aussieht. Und wir lieben diese Geschichte als Beispiel einfach, wie Menschen dort erreicht werden können und auch ganz neu ermutigt werden können, ihr Leben dort als Christus-centered Leben zu gestalten. Das andere Interessante an der Geschichte ist, dass man kann die Verbindung herstellen, ich wiederhole es mit Übereinstimmung, man kann die Verbindung herstellen, dass das der Beginn der syrischen Kirche war. Die Gegend ist dort, wo heute zwar Jordanien ist, aber damals war das Syrien. Also ist, man könnte sagen, die syrische Kirche von einem Verrückten gegründet worden, der von Jesus geheilt hat. Das kann das Leben der Grenzen überschreiten.
So the last thing that we'd like to just talk about is from our experience. What can help this gift flourish in the church, and share a few thoughts on that. This is another photography project. I took a self-portrait. I call this photo "Waiting for the Train That No Longer Arrives." So this is an old railway platform, and it reminded me of church. So the first thing to think about is change. I think lots of cultures, lots of systems have ways of doing things. When the world around us changes, we still do the things that we used to do that once upon a time worked, but they don't resonate in the same way. So I think that the church writ large and ourselves, we need to think carefully about newness and about change, about traditional newness. How do the two fit together? How might we understand processes of change? And I know some people here are pioneers out in the community, and others are pioneers in the church structures. And I think both of these are very important when we think about change. So maybe the train's going somewhere else, and we need to join in with that. One day when I was particularly frustrated with church, I drew this diagram. I'm not expecting you to be able to read it, but let me explain it to you. Up the top is a bishop or a church leader saying, "Yes, we like pioneers," and he's pointing to something that he thinks is a pioneer church, and it has a congregation, Sunday, crucially money, and a priest. So he kind of thinks, great, pioneer, they're going to start a new one of these things called church. Down the bottom here, we've got a pioneer who's crossed the border that says, do not cross. They're wandering. And the pioneer's thinking to themselves, great, the church want me to be a pioneer. But down here, the bishop's thinking, I've got no idea what you're doing. So do you understand the tension in this diagram? that I think in a conversation between pioneers and the church, we need to talk about expectations. I mean, Sebastian, I think you were talking about this yesterday, that because our experience is that a lot of people in the UK who are pioneers are thinking, great, the church really wants pioneers. They start doing what they think is pioneering, but the church doesn't, at times, can't even see it. It seems invisible. They don't even think it's a thing because it doesn't look like what we count. Does that make sense? So I think there are real challenges around talking together about what we mean, what we understand by pioneering, and this adventure of the imagination. I mean, a phrase I sometimes use is the colonized imagination. Sometimes we think, we imagine just in the ways that we already know. We need to see things that are a lot different to that, but to talk about the expectations. A piece of theory I found really helpful is from a Catholic writer, anthropologist called Gerald Arbuckle. And he says if you want to see change in systems, and he's talking about business, societies, as well as the church, he says you actually, what people think is you just need pioneers to do a new thing, and he calls them pathfinding dissenters, or following Hannah, path-seeking dissenters, we should say. So we tend to think we just need some people to do some new things. He says actually, if you want to see systemic change, you need two kinds of dissent. You absolutely need pioneers, practitioners who will go and do new things in mission in the community. We definitely need that. But he says we also need the gift of authority dissent. In other words, people who are in the structures who understand this gift, and they do two. They do a couple of things. One, they see somebody like Steffi and they say, we love what you're about, we love this gift that you bring, go and do that thing. So they spot talent and they set it free. Then what they do is they explain it back to the system. They interpret back to the church. And they also protect the new thing from the system. And the new thing needs to get some distance, otherwise it's going to be criticized all the time. You know, all your energy can go on explaining yourself. So authority dissent is a massive gift. And I know many of you here are in structural positions. You are very important in the landscape of pioneering that's emerging in Germany, or that's my sense of it. It's wonderful that you've got both of these together. And I think if these work together, you're more likely to see flourishing and change. So whichever of these you are, you bring something.
Eine schwierige Gabe. Ich habe die Verbindung gemacht zwischen Wandern und Wundern. Und wenn wir das Wort Wundern nehmen, kommen wir ganz schnell zu verwundet sein. Ich zumindest in meinem Kopf, der nicht mehr ganz so deutlich funktioniert. Verwundet sein. Wir können ganz schnell verwundet werden durch das, was mit uns passiert, zu uns passiert. Aber auch es verwundet in einer gewissen Art und Weise die etablierte Kirche. Und es ist ein schwieriges Gift für beide Seiten. Das Annehmen, das Akzeptieren, das Vergeben, das wieder neu annehmen und wieder neu anfangen. Unsere Kollegin Kathy Ross redet von theologischer Heimatlosigkeit. Das ist im Grunde genommen, was wir sehen, dass Studenten, die lernen, die überlegen und festgestellt haben, wie das gestern schon erwähnt wurde, dass die Theologie, mit der wir aufgewachsen sind, die Systeme, die theologischen Voraussetzungen, Verständnisse nicht mehr so wirklich funktionieren. Und da ist wieder dieses schwierige Loslassen dabei. Wir lassen los und machen uns auf eine Suche nach was Neuem, nach einer neuen Heimat. Und das ist schwierig, das tut weh, das braucht Zeit, das braucht Hilfe. Aber den Mut dazu haben, das ist wichtig. Eines der Hauptdinge, die dabei helfen, ich habe es vorhin schon erwähnt, ist Community, der Sinn von Gemeinschaft und Gemeinde um einen herum. Als Pionier falsch mit mir gleich raushauen müssen, sondern weil das Grenzen überschreitet, Bundesgrenzen überschreitet und da Unterstützung zu finden sein kann.
I've no idea what you said about community. I want to add a couple of things. I mean, I think this gathering is really exciting, really encouraging that you are here talking to each other. But one of the things we've learned about community is that loose networks are good, but actually the kinds of community that have affected change in the church in history are those like the monastic. Did you say this? No. Okay. Good. Like the monastic communities that are spread out in the world. Now the Catholic Church has the best understanding of this, much better than the Church of England. So we're quite the Protestant Church is newer to this, but the Catholic Church has ecclesial communities, church communities. So they're part of church, but they're gathered around a mission task rather than a congregation. So if you think about the Jesuits or the Franciscans, they're this kind of community, a mission community whose purpose is enculturation in the world amongst the poor. So the reason the Catholic Church is so exciting at the moment, I think, is because a Jesuit is the Pope and he's causing havoc. Yeah, that's the gift of this kind of community. So a question for you in Germany, I think, is, you know, what might be the containers or the communities that can nurture this gift, not just in terms of loose friendship and networking, but that might have something like True North that calls you to a life of mission discipleship together. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? I don't know what that is in Germany, but I think we've discovered in England that this kind of thinking of a spread out mission community and how you can connect in with that is important. So CMS, that I work for, has become a religious community of the Church of England in the last 10 years to try and support this gift of mission, not as what we would say parachurch, a bit on the side of church, but as an expression of church. So CMS itself is a fresh expression, but not as a gathered congregational way. You following me? So that's kind of another edge to this community thing. We need friendships, we need networks like this, but there might be a call at some point to develop a new thing in Germany. I don't know, I'm just thinking out loud. So last slide here, I have no idea where I'm going. Anyone care to join me?
Bin nicht so sehr in der Kirche tätig, wie ihr später noch hören werdet, aber
Yeah, I mean, I think the there's a challenge for church in that people don't want to commit into community. They like to hang back and have looser ties. So I think in the wider culture, one of our challenges thinking about church is we might need to be, in terms of spirituality, offer courses for 6 weeks or something that people can come to that they won't join long term. Does that make sense? So I think that's part of the culture, but I think for those who, the kind of community I'm talking about is not for people to join who we are trying to connect with, it's for pioneers themselves. It's a community of support for those of us who feel called to this. So I think there's a sense in which a deep, committed community can be really helpful for us, even though we're working with people that might fear community in that way. So I think both are true. A very post-modern answer. Yeah, I mean, the church spends all of its money and resources on the ordained non-buildings in England as well as Germany, so some things aren't different. But in terms of the students that we train, probably one quarter are training to be ordained as pioneers. You can do that in the Church of England, and three quarters are lay. And many of those who are lay are paying for their own training, and they're not going to be employed by the church. So that is possible. And I think that the research in England around fresh expressions of church shows that of, I don't know, 1,000 or 2,000 new communities that have started, something like 45% have been started by what the researcher calls lay. Laymen. So not just lay, but lay. And what they mean by that is that they are unlicensed or unrecognized and untrained. So they haven't been to our seminaries or whatever. They've got no training, no money, and nearly half of the new communities have been started and led by those. Now, I personally think it's harder to do the enculturation that we're talking about without some engagement with thinking around mission. So I think training can be really useful, but actually there are lots of things being done by people that are not professional, and we need that and we need to encourage that. But, I mean, there are big challenges around resources, and part of the difficult part of the gift is that I think many people hear the church saying we like pioneering. I think it would be great if the church puts more resources into it. You know, so I think, yeah, there's a danger in England, I think, that when people hear about pioneering, they think, oh, we need lay people to do that. And what they mean is they want stuff that's free. So I think it's fine for people to do that, but you need to be arguing with the church for some investment and some resource as well, because this is the future of the church. We have to spend money on this as well as the traditional. And the phrase that's been helpful in England around these two things is mixed economy. And the previous Archbishop, I think, was a very helpful term. He said, you know, traditional church or whatever we call it, contemporary church, etc., that's fine, it's working for some people. So we're not saying let's get rid of that and just do the new. We're saying let's have both, let's have a mixed economy of church, and that's been quite helpful language. Yeah. Sorry, long answer, but.
Barry Stowe,
Evangelische
Methodist Church, Kirche, Frankfurt. Can I speak in English?
Can you speak up, please?
We might not understand him if he speaks in Irish.
Sorry, can you speak up a bit so I can
okay,
hear?
Okay, ich spreche in Deutsch. Also, Authority Descent, du hast das angesprochen. Die amerikanische Kirche hat radikale Änderungen gemacht, um Pioneer Ministry zu ermöglichen, auch strukturell. Also was für die amerikanische Kirche wirklich ein big deal ist, eine große Sache ist. Habt ihr Tipps, wie wir in der Leitungsebene unserer Kirchen hier in Deutschland dieses Permission Giving gewinnen können? Was, natürlich ist es durch den Geist Gottes am Ende, aber gibt es andere Tipps, Hinweise, Vorschläge, wie wir uns öffnen könnten für solche Pioneer Ministries, dass diese Permission Giving von der Leitungsebene der Kirche kommt? Just an easy question.
It's difficult. I mean, I'm slightly worried because I hear people in Germany talking about the Church of England and fresh expressions like it's going really well. I mean, there are some dioceses in England where they say we don't do pioneers and they have no fresh expressions and they don't want it. So there are other places that are flourishing. So it's a very mixed picture and it is difficult. People don't like change, so that's why I think there's not an answer, but you need to find friends who are open to possibility. And I think it's it's encouraging that there are structural people here, because I think it's getting people to connect with that conversation, to understand it, to build friendships. One of Martin's reflections on his visit to England was that we don't do enough in England to communicate to the church about what is happening, and perhaps we should do more. We kind of put lots of effort to communicate with people outside the church, but we just think we can talk any old out of the church. Maybe we need to put more effort into that. So I think it's extremely important to pay attention to that, but there are no easy answers to it other than patience, trying to build friendship, and I think being prophetic. You know, there's a call to speak to. There's some people who particularly have this calling. So I see my role as being bilingual, and not German English, sadly, but able to talk and be with pioneers and get that, but also able to talk and interpret to the church. And perhaps, Sandra, this is your role, gift and role too, to be Maria, I don't know. We need people that are able to talk in both directions as well as people in both of those spaces. So I think it's difficult, but you need to keep working at that conversation. And pray. I mean, it really helped in England that the Archbishop, Rowan Williams, was a friend of Fresh Expressions. I mean, that lots was possible because of his sympathy to that movement. So look for people like that. And it may be very different in Germany. I mean, that's one of the things I wanted to say, was that just because there are some things happening in England, you don't copy them. Don't try and do that. You know, the question is, what is the adventure of the imagination in Linden or in Berlin, or where, you know, wherever you are? What is that possibility? What is the German gift, redemptive gift, that could be shared with the world? What does that look like? That's what I'd love to see. So, by all means, have your imagination sparked by England, but don't do the same thing. It's your challenge, your question, your adventure to think, what does this look like in my culture, my community, my country, whether that's in the north or Bavaria or eastern Germany, and I realize they're all a little bit different from my conversations with people that speak like that.
Es gab jetzt einige Meldungen schon, die haben Zeit für zwei oder drei, die hatten muss ich dann auch die Kaffeepause verfüßen, die erste war.
Philipp Wedau, Missionar in Hannover. Pioneering ist ja bei uns sehr schüchtern. Schüchtern der Anfänger. Es kommt mir im Moment vor, wie eine Fahrt zwischen Skiller und Charybdis. Skiller konnten wir erleben in der rheinischen Landeskirche. Hervorragende Papierlage, tolles Papier. Pressemeldung der Landeskirche, das wird so dargestellt, als ob, naja, das Ausnahmefall ist, Normalfall ist ja die Ortsgemeinde. Und Pioneering ist das Nice to Have oben drauf, wo man ahnt schon, weniger Ressourcen, wir verabschieden uns vom Nice to Have. Charybdis erleben wir ein bisschen in Hannover. Da gibt es einen tollen Fonds missionarische Chancen. Der Bischof ist ganz tuschi bei diesem Fonds dabei, 500.000 Euro im Jahr, um ein Projekt zu beantragen. Da geht es um neue Sozialformen von Kirche und Gemeinde. Muss das durch den Kirchenkreisvorstand laufen? Das heißt, der Weg ist so churchy, dass selbstverständlich nur Churchy-Ideen rauskommen. Und der Bischof wundert sich, ja, dass es zu wenig Grund ist. Also diese beiden Wege ist klar gewünscht. Also einmal nice to have und auf der anderen Seite das Neue kommt zu Church hinterher, im Sinn auf die Vermischen gesinkt. Wie seid ihr denn Herr Lange umgegangen? Welchen Kurs habt ihr eingeschlagen?
And I think resourcing, we have to find a way to make a way where there is no way. You know, that's what pioneering is. And I think part of the challenge is, how are you going to resource it? So I think there are many answers to that question. We have some people who marry somebody rich. That's a good, that's a tip. If you're not already married, yeah. We have people who raise support, much like people do in mission, to go elsewhere. So they raise support from individuals and churches and ask them to give. They put a vision in front of them and they support them in that way. I think that can be helpful. We have people, I think it's becoming more common to develop a mix of ways of supporting things. So people who work part-time and do ministry part-time. So Bernie, who I showed you a picture of, she lives actually in a very poor way, and she works one day a week as a consultant. And she's a single mum, she has a son, Felix, who's 17, but she does 4 days a week pioneering, living off very little. That's how she resources what she's doing. We run, one of the modules we run is on missional entrepreneurship, so setting up kind of enterprises and businesses that are transforming in themselves. So we're seeing quite a number of people who are developing businesses alongside their pioneering that generate some money towards it. I mean, it's quite typical that they might have a mix of support and a mix of pioneering. In the Church of England, there are a number of roles that you can do which are called getting a house for duty. This is a bit technical. So you basically there's a lot of church properties, and you could live in a church property if you do a little bit of work for the church, and often it would be a small church with not many people. So there's a number of people who are taking one of those things, doing a little bit of church work, and doing things in the community. So, I mean, that's 7 or 8 possibilities, but I think about this question together and dream some dreams. I think what isn't helpful is to think, why won't the church give me any money and moan about it? The church isn't going to give you money, probably. I mean, or you're going to have to present a really good case. So think about the resourcing as part of pioneering. And there are many, many ways I think that could be done. We probably need all of them.
spirituelle Pastoral pushen möchte. Obwohl eine Entwicklung auch, die der katholischen Kirche schon seit dem Prinzip eigentlich gelaufen ist, wie man in jeder Welt nennen könnte. Und das lohnt sich sehr. Also Kundschaft daraus zu senden, so wie das damals bei den Ständischen war, um zu gucken, das kann man auch zeitlich begrenzen, wie man hier ist. Und dann Erfahrung austauschen. Das lohnt sich sehr.
Frage, glaube ich, gefunden oder lässt denken? Nein.
Okay, das war schön.
I think this is quite difficult for pioneers, and I think I'm not sure what you said on difficult, but the journey from the old to the new, a lot of pioneers think it would be great if I could just jump to the new and do the new thing, but invariably what we found is that that journey goes through wilderness, or desert, or darkness, or chaos, liminality, it has many names, but there's a difficult place of pain on the way to the new, and often wilderness is a place of letting go, of stripping. It's a creative place, it's a place where ideas come as well, and I think it's often in that place that people realize the pain that their old ways of speaking about God and indeed, some of the resources that have helped them in the old will not work in the new landscape. So there's a challenge of letting go of many of those things to find and discover the gospel and what that might be like together with a new community in a new space. So that's what I think we mean by homelessness, is that these things that have been good, resourced faith in this place, we have to leave that behind in order to find a new. Now, in terms of mission, this is normal. If you study mission, Vincent Donovan goes to work with the Maasai. He needs to find a new way of speaking about God in that space. This is cross-cultural mission, and one of the ways of talking about it in mission is that mission should be self-governing, self-replicating. The three self thing. But a fourth one has been added in a lot of places, which is self-theologizing. So you've got to do the theological thinking. And that's not to say that the tradition is bad. There's lots of treasure here. But the challenge is, how do you open this treasure up in a way that connects and remixes with the cultural stuff that's here? So it's not a kind of this is bad, this is good, but it's more a kind of unlearning and a rediscovering here. So in terms of theology, with our students, we tend to teach theological reflection. Or in other words, theology is a verb, a process. How do you speak and think about God and draw on the tradition to connect with the questions of this community? Because the theology over here is often answering questions that were from another time and another era. So I'm going to say this in front of a German audience, I'm not a fan of systematic theology. I think that belongs to a modern era. You know, we need to find theology that connects now. There's treasure in it, of course, but the way of speaking is dry and doesn't connect here. So theological reflection, but don't hear me saying that that's an excuse for pioneers to be lazy. Because actually, the better you know the tradition, and not just your theological tradition, but read some African theology, some feminist theology, some whatever, that will enrich the improvisation in this space. So it's not a call to be lazy, it's actually a call to know the tradition deeper, but in order to be able to improvise out of it in the new space. So it's a very short answer. Students who study with us are going on a three-year journey, and this is typical of education, I think, generally, but you know, a student at the end of year one, they might say something like, I feel like I don't know much anymore. So that there's a kind of, you know, you, to find a new language, you've got to let go of some things. There's a process to be in, as it were. I mean, yeah, there are other people pioneering who just do a church plant, and they take the old theology and do it in a new space, and they don't worry about any of these questions. So you might like to try that maybe.